On this new episode of the Thoughts of Redemption podcast, I am joined by my guest, PK Kersey, author, founder of That Suits You, an organization that was created to provide suits for men in need, and much more. We were able to have a conversation about why he started the organization and whom these suits are provided for. And we were also able to talk about his book that is soon to be released that is dedicated to children called That Suits You Kid. I was really excited to have this conversation with him, and I hope you have a great experience listening. God bless. Welcome, everybody, to the Thoughts of Redemption podcast. I'm your host, Lamar Gibbs. And on this episode of the podcast, I have a very special guest that is joining me, and just going to give a little short introduction before he introduces himself. PK Kersey is the founder and president of That Suits You, an organization that was created to help men that are in need of suits, that are in need of being able to get into the workforce, being able to improve self-image, et cetera, et cetera. He's also an author and so much more. But PK, thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it, sharing your platform with me. I take it seriously. So thank you for allowing me to be on.
Yeah, absolutely, man. It's an honor to have you on here. So just let the people know a little bit about yourself.
All right, cool. My name is PK Kersey. Born and raised in Brooklyn. Been married 29 years. I have twin boys, Kellen, Kai. After working, you mentioned That Suits You. Yeah, it started basically from after working for New York State Motor Vehicle for 24 and a half years and really wanting to do something more with my life, with my gifts, with my talents, really trying to find out what talents and gifts I really could use. And just really started working in different, multi-level marketing companies. I started a little business. You know, I tried different things to try to find my way about what I was going to do, but nothing really seemed to kick or really get me excited or prosper. I used to always interview men for work at DMV, and DMV was primarily like 70-80% females. And I used to always wonder why a lot of the men weren't being hired. And I started seeing that when I was part of the interview process, sadly, a lot of them weren't really job ready or interview ready as far as knowing what to say, how to say, how to sit, proper posture and proper dress. And it became evident why they weren't really being hired. And I felt bad about that because coming from Brooklyn, I know how important it is to have money, have a job, have something, because if you don't have that, you're going to wind up, it's so easy to get caught up and do the negative things, get caught in the wrong crowd, because you want to have money, you want to be able to provide. So when you can't, it becomes a huge issue. So that kind of put a seed in my heart to want to lean toward doing something for my community.
That's awesome. That's awesome, man. And so you said you're from Brooklyn. I was actually born in Brooklyn myself. I was born in Bed-Stuy. Yeah. And you said you're a twin, right?
I have twin boys.
You have twin boys. I'm actually, I'm a twin.
Okay. That's what's up.
Yeah. So
identical.
So when we, yep. Identical. Okay.
My boys are fraternal. Man.
Nice. So when I first got introduced to you, it was at the Brooklyn by Faith Awards back in 2018. Okay. You had accepted the community award. And, you know, as I was looking up the video of just going back, because it was just reminiscent, I was like, wow, just remembering being back at that award and how special it was with everybody that was there. But you had mentioned in your speech that God had gave you the idea for That Suits You.
Right.
And so you were explaining literally like him speaking to you. So can you like talk to us about that experience?
Yeah.
And then also just to share, as a recipient, how did it feel being honored that way?
Yeah, definitely, man. And that's something that's totally true. You know, people say, God spoke to me, and people think, yeah, you know, finding hard to believe it, but I can definitely attest to that. I said I have twin boys, so at that time it was just me and my wife, and she had, we were married for at least, I think, 18, 17 years, and we didn't have any kids. She's had a couple of miscarriages and stuff. So we were basically, it was me and her, and we had both had, solid jobs, not making huge amounts of money, but we were doing, pretty well, especially it's just the two of us. And so then she got pregnant, and because she had so many complications, she couldn't, the doctor immediately put her on bed rest, like after the fourth month. So we went from two people, two incomes, to now two people still, but one income. And then found out, like, forgot what month, we found out that she was having twins. So now we went from two and two to one and four. So that was a, that was like, wow. So I had this, working with DMV, I did pretty well there as far as I got received like four or five promotions. I was manager, different thing. But as management, you can't really make any overtime. So, no matter how many hours I work, I received the same amount of money. So I said, God, I got these kids coming. My wife's not working right now. We living in Brooklyn. What, I need to make more money. And what can I do? What should I do? So as funny, and people always laugh when I say it, but when I said that, the answer that I received in my heart and my spirit was that I want you to start giving away suits to men so that they can get back to work. And every time I hear that, I'm like, that in no way in my mind answers the question that I posed to him, right? If I'm asking, how can I make, because this was a total, I guess you could say it's total selfish prayer, but I'm thinking about preservation. I have to provide. I'm a first time father, da da da. And the answer he said that I received, that I heard in my spirit, was, I want you to start giving away suits to men so that they can get back to work. Now, just think about that for a minute. That doesn't answer to me. That doesn't answer my question. Actually, that causes more work for me because now I have to locate suits, get suits, store suits, find out people who need suits. I have to do all this extra work, all of this extra, and none of that really seems to coincide with more money coming back into my pocket, which was my initial prayer. But lo and behold, that one statement back in 2012 revolutionized my whole life, changed the whole trajectory of my life. And as a result of that one word, that one answer that I heard, everything about me is totally different. And that's so to receive that award is, I don't want to say a culmination, but it's like a sign that that was accurate. And the fact that I'm no longer at the place where I could not see myself leaving except by retirement. You know what I mean? The place that helped me pay my bills for 20 some years, I'm not even there anymore. And to hear, to understand that, you have to really understand me as a person. I was raised by my mother and father, and they, my mother worked for Verizon for 25 years, and no, 30 years retired. My father worked for Transit for 20 something years and retired. So they instilled in us that this is the path to success, which is nothing wrong with that. But for me, that not to even be a part of that anymore after that was indoctrinated into me is just a testimony to how powerful the word of God can be when you listen to it, when you hear it, receive it, and that it definitely can change your whole everything about you.
I wholeheartedly agree with that. And the crazy thing is like, I too have experienced God speaking to me about things, but I've also experienced him directing me through other people and them giving me advice. So for what I'm doing now with Thoughts of Redemption, this too was a God thing. This too was something that God was speaking into my heart, because growing up and going to school, my desire was to go to school and to be a game designer. But all the while going through high school, I started writing on MySpace, writing MySpace blogs, and then on Facebook, writing Facebook notes, and just constantly writing, and just sharing my heart, sharing things that I believe that God was revealing to me in the scriptures, and et cetera, et cetera. And It wasn't until a group of friends and my brothers encouraged me, hey, you should actually look into writing. And then I started to look into it. And I distinctly remember on that one moment where I took literally like a notepad and I had a pen and I just went before the Lord in prayer. I was just like, as I'm coming up with a blog, as I'm moving towards transitioning towards doing writing and everything. And so as I was striving to come up with the actual name of the blog, my heart's desire was to have a name that defined like the passion that I had for writing and the things that just God was constantly leading me towards. And I surrendered it to him in prayer. And then he, as I was literally writing out different phrases, he led me to the phrase of Thoughts of Redemption. And ever since then, there's been layer after layer of ways that God has revealed the meaning of this phrase to me, to the point where you go to a couple of years later. I started in 2014, the blog, and then you go to, I want to say, what, 2016, maybe 2017, sorry, 2017. And then I felt the Lord leading me. He said, basically, I felt him leading me saying, Thoughts of Redemption is going to involve mental health. And up until that point in time, I was just thinking Thoughts of Redemption was just changing your thinking and being able to have like a biblical mindset. But then it expanded my perspective, and then it, and from then it has expanded like the amount of things that could possibly happen, it could possibly be used for Thoughts of Redemption, and that kind of stuff is like you're asking the questions literally like, yo, like how am I gonna do this? How am I gonna get the resources? How am I gonna to build this
Right,
thing?
right.
And but then God is still with you, and so. Yeah, man, I can definitely identify when God is actually speaking to you, and then He leads you and He provides for you, and He challenges you too,
Right, right.
to grow further than where you were.
Right.
And so, as I look at you and I see what that suits you has become, and just the avenues and the people that it has impacted, I just thank God for it. And so, as of right now, in the recording of this podcast, just looking at your site, you've said you've served nearly 9,000 men so far.
Right, yeah.
And what would you say has been the biggest moment you've experienced when helping somebody get a new suit?
I mean, it's been so many like amazing moments, but the ones that really stand out to me, because it's the evolution of it. So initially, we started assisting men coming home from prison. So we were working with job training program, which we still do. All of this we still do, but the first base was helping men coming home from prison, which is very important to me because I said, when I'm from Brooklyn, a lot of my friends wound up in prison. And sometimes when you get that prison sentence, it's like a death sentence as far as success or business or working. So to be able to help some of them get back to work, get back on their feet, and give some of these men suits, and they seem so appreciative of it, where they're like, wow, thank you. Because so many people haven't had that father figure or someone even just to give them something. So here we're giving them $500 to $1,000 suits for free with ties and everything. So that's the one aspect. The second aspect, we moved on to high schools, where we wanted to reach high schools for prom and graduation, but also give them the suiting tips, the tie, how to tie a tie, how to tie a bow tie. So that was another big milestone for us to get into New York City schools. Very important. And then I guess the third, going down even lower, when we started getting into grade schools last year before the pandemic hit, and to see the young kids, like they're so like, they were so like ready to receive, like excited about it, like hanging on every word. High school kids, college kids, they could try to be cool, like because everybody wants to be so cool. But the grade kids, they just was on hanging on every word and loving it, and just seeing that smile and knowing that some of them were going home to tough situations, some of them were going home to not ideal situations at home, but just to give them a little glimmer of hope here and a gift of a suit or a book or some laughter, some they can use for their future. That was, I guess, if you add all those bases up, that would be the home run for everything.
Yeah, and I think that's so powerful that it can really not only impact the lives of people and what they want to do, you know, and getting the jobs and everything, but it can also impact the way they see themselves and their way of thinking.
Right.
And so I would ask, how would you sum up basically when you see somebody putting on that suit or getting a suit for the first time, or, you know what I mean, wearing a suit, like what would you say that it does to a man personally, like when he has a suit?
First thing I notice is that they stand up straight. Like, it just makes you take notice. Because we talk about, we have a program called Choices. Because to us, the suit is the icing on the cake, but the knowledge that we give is more important. So Choices stands for change, habits, options, image, communication, effort equals success. So we use those different letters to kind of break it down of, you know, why it's so important, to make great choices in your life. So we put the suit on them and see them stand up straight. And then when we teach them, show them how to tie different knots, to see how they capture that. And then they're like really proud and say, look, you know, look what I've done. Look what it took me 2 seconds to get this skill, but they like treasure it. Like it's something major. And we tell them it is major because not a lot of men have that experience. So it's not just the learning how to tie. It's the camaraderie. It's the sharing that you just experienced with another gentleman, showing you how to do something.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. Just wearing suits is so transformative. And, you know, as I was looking at the video, I saw a comment that really stood out to me. And I wanted to ask just your thoughts on this. So have you ever gotten any pushback for promoting suit wear? And I'm only asking this, like I said, because I saw a comment that said, wearing a suit is like wearing a white man's suit.
Yeah.
And the greatest criminals wear suits. So what do you think about that?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we're here for all of it. I'm prepared when people say, you know, oh, you just promoting the white man's image of what? that's like if somebody talks proper English, they say, oh, you talking like a white person. Like that's.
Yeah, oh man, I hate that.
Yeah, that goes to the person's mentality. I mean, and that's something that also needs to be addressed. Like, okay, why do you feel that way? And then once you really have that, it all starts with communication. Once you have that communication of why the person feels that way, and then you explain your situation, 9 times out of 10, they'll be like, well, you know, I never looked at it like that. Well, I mean, that's why that's why we're teaching this. That's why we're letting, it's not a white person thing. It's not it has nothing to do with that. And it really, you know, it goes, like I said, hand in hand when somebody talks differently or proper, that's first thing I say, you sound white. So both of those pretty much go hand in hand, and you have to find out, well, why do you feel that way? What makes you feel that way? And when you have that conversation, you can generally explain to them. So yeah, we get that plenty of times, you know. So that's nothing new to us.
Yeah. And so I just want to pivot real quick, and because you mentioned about what you do in your organization beyond just giving men suits, so I just want you to talk a little bit more about just the work that is being done in the community with the young kids and the men, how you mentorships and everything else that you do. As you're an author, of course, like I mentioned in the beginning. So, just talk about that.
Right. So, the real part of it is the training, which we love to do. We try to teach them certain gems that will stand out, because, you know, the suit is easy to give somebody a suit, but a lot of times that won't change their mentality or their thinking. But if you can teach about the importance of it, like we have, we talk to them about one question I love to ask every class we go to is I say, how many people here believe that they can make $30,000 a year? And in the high school class, you know, maybe if it's 20 students, maybe 18 to 20 will have their hand up. I say, okay, that's great. We got involvement.
If you haven't heard about Anchor, it's the easiest way to make a podcast. Let me explain. It's free, There's creation tools that allow you to record and edit your podcast right from your phone or computer. Anchor will distribute your podcast for you so it can be heard on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and many more. A lot of you are probably hearing this from Spotify or Apple Podcasts. So this is how I did it. You can make money from your podcast with no minimum listenership, and it's everything you need to make a podcast in one place. So download the free Anchor app or go to anchor.fm to get started.
$30,000 a month, and out of the 18 who raised their hand previously, maybe 9 or 10 raised their hand. Mm-hmm. And then we'll go to $30,000 a week. How many people believe they can make that? And then out of that 9, it'll probably go down to maybe 2. And then we say $30,000 a day, and nobody raises their hand. And so we all look at each other, and I say, well, you know what? Remember what I asked you. I said, I didn't ask you how can you make it $30,000 a week or how you can make $30,000 a day. I just asked you, do you believe that you can do it? And we tell them that everything starts with belief. If you don't believe that you can achieve something, then you'll never be able to reach that goal or that dream that you have. So everything starts with belief. So we try to instill a strong belief in them about what they can do, because you don't know how. If you believe it, a lot of times you'll find out on the way.
Right.
Yeah. So the workshops that we do, we kind of it all starts with a strong mindset and then a strong image, and then we go into branding themselves and marketing themselves. I still take care of my 95-year-old uncle, and when he just called me, actually, one of the things he always says is dress how you want to be addressed. So as you want to be addressed, that's how you're going to dress and prepare yourself.
That's good, man. As you were talking about how you believe and how you think about yourself, it made me think of Dr. A.R. Bernard and the quote that he often says, it's the statement that he often makes, where he says, the quality of your thinking determines the quality of your life.
Yeah. And yeah. Dr. Bernard is awesome.
Yeah, man. Absolutely.
He's actually been a big supporter and donator. He donated like about 200 of his suits to us.
That's fantastic. Wow. I did not know that.
Yeah. Yeah. That's awesome. He's dynamite.
Yeah, man. That's really awesome. I really love that. And so, yeah, like I can definitely agree, and I'm glad to see that, you know, beyond just the suits, as important as it is, that, you know, being able to instill in them just these values and being able to help people to change their way of thinking is so important.
Right.
And so as an author, right, so can you tell us a bit about, like, some of the books that you've written? I know that you have a few coming out, and I'm going to talk about one specifically that I'm really excited to talk about, but just share with us a little bit about some of the writings that you've published.
Right. Like, who would have thought that I would have been an author? Definitely not me. I never really even considered it until the last few years at DMV. But two of the first two books that I'm part of, they would say the visionary of, is called Suited for Success, Volume 1 and 2. And each book features 25 Black and brown men basically sharing their life story of what they had to do to succeed in life, the challenges they faced being raised by a single parent, parents on drugs, being bullied in school, all different types of scenario from men all over the country. And they put it in paper basically together to form Suited for Success. And it's basically tailored for young men, but basically people to read and understand that if they went through these things and were successful, then, you know, I can go through my situations and still be successful. I always say everyone has a path to success. It may not look like anyone else's, but there is a path. There is a journey that will lead to amazing success, but you just have to be willing to go through it. The next two books are actually upcoming. One is our first children's book. Me and my brother, we did it. It's called That Suits You, Kid. It's about a kid,
Yes.
a young boy who pretty smart, and he gets an award, and he's going to a ceremony, but he doesn't have the proper attire to wear. So goes from his father and lessons about importance of image. And also, I have another book collaboration coming out called Still I Thrive, with men and women sharing their, I guess you could say testimonies, but their challenges that they went, every, we all went through in 2020 with COVID and election and riots and different things, and how they were still able to manage businesses or homes or families and to be successful, and the little ins and outs that try to help other people to get through and to come out on top as well.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. And just like you mentioned, that Sushu kid, that this is the reason why I really wanted to like even bring you on. Of course, amongst other reasons, but this was so exciting to me just to see you coming out with this. So, tell us what sparked the starting of this and how it all came together.
Me and my brother, we both founders of That Suits You, and we both have young children. He has two girls, I have two boys, and they're in school, and they were always reading these books about different things, and we was like, we can change the narrative, or we can have our write our own story about what it is that we're doing, and call it That Suits You Kids, so young black boys really can have a representation when they read it of to see it's an amazing thing to see image of yourself in a book or in television or in the movies, and that really makes a big difference. It was I just think about when growing up seeing T black shows like Good Times or What's Happening, like when I saw those shows, like I really felt good seeing a representation of me on the screen or in the movie. So we want to have that same impact on young kids, so they can see themselves. Oh, did you read that book, That Suits You Kid? Like, so they can have a representation and see how they look and how that can instill something strong and powerful in them.
I definitely get that, man. You
Yeah.
know, even in the modern day, we're making history as black men and women.
Yeah.
And so, and even in light of that, I wanted to ask you, just in honor of Black History Month, who are the black men and women that have inspired you the most?
Personally, definitely my I have to say stepfather for identification, but my father, he raised me. Unfortunately, he passed 2 years ago, but the example that he set of the way he loved, cared for, provided for my mother, just always being there, taught me how to tie my first tie. His example is unmatched to anyone. Also, my uncle, who I take care of now, he's an amazing. He's 95, and he's just as strong and he's just an amazing man. He's had that impact on me to that I really appreciate everything that he's put inside of me. As far as people that I saw like on TV or anything, I was saying Muhammad Ali. He was one of the people that really stood out to me because in that day and age, for him to be flat-footed and unashamed and still bold and still outside the ring, he wore suits, he was confident, as he would say, handsome. He had it all, and he was a modern day he was a leader and hero. I mean, they didn't respect him then, but when they look back in retrospect, they see what type of leader he was. And even to this day, what Colin Ka Kaepernick did, the stance that he took. So many different leaders that really made an impact on me. And even Black Enterprise CEO Earl Graves, he for him to invite me to his house to pick up suits and donate suits, because like not like one time, I've been there several times, and just to have that type of relationship because of something that, as I stated in the first when we first started talking in the interview, something that God placed in my heart. I mean, it's just crazy how it has impacted and grown.
Yeah, man. It's so tremendous, so tremendous, you know, and that's so good. I think about like just the people, you know, around me, like my own father. He was the one that taught me how to tie a tie, got me into wearing suits, and so, you know, I honor him for that, and of course my mother, and then I even think about like people in history. Just thinking on the question today, I reflected. I was like, you know, the people that inspired me. It's this woman named Harriet Jacobs and Frederick Douglass. And they both were former slaves. One actually had, you know, escaped. And Frederick Douglass himself was freed, and, you know, was able to, you know, learn how to read and do all that kind of stuff. And then also like continuing his faith in Christ. The same with Harriet Jacobs. You know, she was able to tell the difference between the Christ of the scriptures versus the Christ of the slave masters, and the way that they would want to use it as a tool of oppression. And so, yeah, man. But I just want to like end this off and say that again, that I really appreciate you for taking the time to just have this conversation with me, and just grateful to be able to share the value of what that suit you brings to the people and to the culture. And so, before we end this off, just let the people know where they can contact you, where they can donate suits, you know, where they can donate money, anything that can help to push this mission forward.
Keep doing the work that you're doing is definitely making an impact, and keep that vision. People who want to contact me, Instagram, Facebook, at that suits you, THATSUITSYU. Also go to our website, www.thatsuitsyou.org. I'm also on LinkedIn, Facebook, and Instagram, PK Kersey. Reach out. You can make a financial donation. You could contact us about making a clothing donation. We're pretty specific and about the things that we accept. So contact us first, and we'll let you know how if we accept it. And we definitely will be grateful for any donations that we get. But hit us up on social media. We're always on social media. Hit us, send us a DM, and you know, we also have the books that we have that are for, you can purchase, and also we have some merchandise. You know, we have hoodies and t-shirts that suit you. So reach out to us, contact us. We go to schools, we go to colleges, we teach young people. We're always willing to be involved in the community. So yeah, reach out to us.
Definitely, definitely. Yeah, so thank you so much again, and to everybody else listening, always remember to celebrate the process of thinking and God's hand in it. If you want to contact me for anything, you can email me at thoughtsofredemption@gmail.com. If you want to reach out to me on Instagram, this Instagram is Thoughts of Redemption. Facebook, this Facebook page is Thoughts of Redemption. Twitter, the Twitter page is _TO Redemption. And as always, the website is thoughtsofredemption.com. So we thank you guys, and God bless y'all.